we should move on and we thank the speaker. Next talk is by Moritz Hasselbauer from the University of Bonn, and the topic is galaxies lacking dark matter in the illustrious universe.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here in Prague and giving a talk about galaxies lacking dark matter in the illustrious simulation. My name is Moritz Hasselbauer and I'm a master student supervised by Paul Grupper. But I also would like to mention Hossein Hage, Jörg Dabringhausen, and Benan Yavanmardi, because they also have contributed to my work here, which I will show. So I will start with a short overview. So I will start my presentation with a motivation why this is so important to study galaxies lacking dark matter. Then we jump into the illustrious simulation. And then I will present the results of simulated tidal dwarf galaxies, and I will compare them with observations. And this also includes the recently observed NGC 1052 DF2 galaxy, which where Van Dokkum et al. 2018 claimed that this is a dark matter lacking galaxy. And finally, I will give implications for Lambda CDM cosmology and a conclusion. So, the motivation for my talk is the so-called dual dwarf theorem, which was formulated in 2012 by Paul Grupper, which states that any viable cosmological model in which galaxies interact predicts the existence of primordial and tidal dwarf galaxies. In particular, when we are going to the Lambda CDM cosmology, this means that we get dark matter-containing dwarf galaxies. So these are typically primordial dark matter dominated galaxies which form in the very early universe, and they are spheroidal distributed around the host galaxy. But in contrast to this, we also have tidal dwarf galaxies which are formed later on because of the formation scenario of galaxies. So when galaxies interact, then we have tidal forces, which creates the expulsion of gas and stars. And this gas and stars create tidal arms, and overdensities in these tidal arms collapse and grows in mass. And these overdensities become the new galaxies, which are called tidal dwarf galaxies. And due to this formation scenario of two interacting galaxies, these tidal dwarf galaxies are correlated in phase space. So this is an observed tidal dwarf galaxy. So we see here the bulge in the middle. Then we also have this galaxy labeled with B. So these are two observed galaxies which interact. And here we can see a tidal arm. And here this overdenses, and these nodes are collapsing, and these are then tidal dwarf galaxies. And based on the different formation scenarios of dwarf galaxies with dark matter or without, we can distinguish them based on their radii, because tidal dwarf galaxies formed out naked without the help of dark matters, and in order to be gravitationally bound, they have to be very compact. In contrast to this, dwarf galaxies dominated by dark matter have these dark matter particles around them, and so they don't have to be that compact as tidal dwarf galaxies in order to be gravitationally bound. So in my analysis, I'm using the illustrious simulation, which is a self-consistent heterodynamically cosmological simulation. Self-consistent in this means that it starts at a very high redshift and then it evolves stars, gas, dark matter particles and black holes through cosmic time up to redshift zero. And for this, they assumed a Lambda CDM cosmology consistent with the WMAP9 measurements. Okay. Now we jump into the illustrious simulation and we apply selection criteria for different types of dwarf galaxies. Let me start with simulated dark matter containing dwarf galaxies. I will call them DMC tidal dwarf galaxies. And here I look at the subhalos in the Lastra simulation, and they claim that they have to have a dark matter mass larger than zero, a stellar mass between 5 × 10⁻⁷ and the upper limit of 10⁹. Then the host galaxy is larger than 10⁹ solar masses in the stellar mass, and at least 10 times larger than the stellar mass of the dwarf galaxy. And the minimum criterion for the stellar mass is motivated by the resolution of the Lastra simulation. So here I would want to be sure that these galaxies are well resolved with at least 50 stellar particles, and of course an upper limit because we are looking at dwarf galaxies. And furthermore, I set a distance criteria that dark matter containing dwarf galaxies lie between 10 and 100 times the stellar half-light radius of the host. The minimum distance criterion is motivated by two facts. First of all, it could be that subhalos are substructures within the disk of a galaxy. So they are not real galaxies, but just substructures, so we include them. And the number 10 is motivated by the distance of the Milky Way to the Large Magellanic Cloud, which is around 50 kiloparsec, divided by the 3D deprojected half-light radius of the Milky Way, which is around 5. So I thought 10 is a nice value. And then I also set an upper value because observational catalogs only focus on dwarf galaxies near or which are located close to their host galaxy. So this is an upper value. And then we are doing exactly the same, but here we set that the dark matter mass is zero because here we are looking for tidal dwarf galaxy candidates. And according to their formation, they should be dark matter free or at least show a lack of dark matter. I haven't set here an upper limit because I was interested how massive such galaxies can become. And then the host galaxy and the distance criteria are exactly the same as for dark matter containing dwarf galaxies. So the situation is like this. We have in the middle a host. So all subhalos which are found 10 times smaller than the effective radius are neglected. And then we just look at these galaxies which are within 100 times the effective radii. Red are tidal dwarf galaxies and green ones are dark matter containing dwarf galaxies. So these are now our samples. So here I refer to sample R, which is my main sample. It states that the stellar mass, as I have told you, is 5 × 10⁷ solar masses with no constraint on the gas mass. And here we find 97. But when we neglect this upper limit here, we find 98. And this is consistent with the formation scenario of tidal dwarf galaxies because they are expected to form in the vicinity of the host galaxies because they are formed through encounters. Then I also introduced sample B, where I said a constraint on the gas mass, which is 5 × 10⁷, and that this object has at least one stellar particle. And here we get much more galaxies. The reason is also because of the formation scenarios of these galaxies, because they are formed out of the gaseous disk. Yes, and then here is the dark matter containing dwarf galaxy sample. So you can see that we get much more galaxies. These are primordial ones. And interestingly, when we divide them now for dark matter rich and dark matter poor based on the dark matter to baryonic ratio, then we can also find galaxies with a ratio smaller than one, but the numbers are incredibly small. But also here we find most of this dark matter lacking dwarf galaxies in the close region to a host galaxy. So this is a first hint that tidal dwarf galaxies can maybe capture dark matter particles. Because tidal dwarf galaxies, the gravitational potential of tidal dwarf galaxies is too small to capture dark matter particles which have a very high velocity dispersion. So now I would like to show some images of simulated galaxies. So here we have the host, and these are dark matter-free objects, but they do not fulfill the distance criterion, so they are within 10 times the effective radii of the host, and so my algorithm identifies them as dark matter-free substructures. Why I showed this? Because I would like to point out that our minimum threshold is very restrictive. This is exactly the same, but here we have the gas density and not the stellar luminosities. Here we can see a gaseous tidal arm where these nodes can be found. And when one calculates now the specific orbital angular momentum with respect to this host galaxy, we find the clustering of this vector, meaning that these galaxies or these objects here are phase-space correlated. And when one converts this in an angle, this is around 6 degrees, the angle between these two vectors. This is an example of a very evolved tidal dwarf galaxy candidate, because here again, this is the host one. This is the found tidal dwarf galaxy. It has a huge amount of stellar particles, so more than 10 to the power of 8. And the green one are dark matter rich dwarf galaxies. But when we switch now to the gas densities, we see that there's not a tidal arm anymore, and so one can conclude that this is probably an older object where the gas component was already transformed to stars and dark matter rich ones. And just one last example which I would like to show is this one, which is very interesting, because here we can also find dark matter poor substructures and dark matter poor dwarf galaxies in the same region as tidal dwarf galaxies with a huge amount of gas. When we go to the gaseous one, we can see here that we have a very nice tidal arm, where in these knots we can find this dark matter poor and tidal dwarf galaxies. So calculating again specific orbital angular momentum vectors, we can also see a clustering. So these are again phase-space correlated, and which is what is extremely nice here, that this is again a hint that tidal dwarf galaxies can maybe capture at least very few or small amount of dark matter particles. So this is the total mass distribution of simulated tidal dwarf galaxies. Here the total mass versus the fraction normalized, so by the highest value is 1. And here we find a highest value of 3.1 times 10 to the power of 9 solar masses. So this mass spectrum is also consistent with high resolution simulations of galaxy encounters by Bourneau. And what is highly interesting here, that this value here is more or less comparable with the Large Magellanic Cloud, because there is the idea that the Large Magellanic Cloud is a tidal dwarf galaxy, which was formed by a previous encounter with, for example, Andromeda galaxy. And here in the simulation, we can find such galaxies with a similar amount of stellar mass. Okay, now a small reminder about the dual dwarf theorem. According to the dual dwarf theorem, we have primordial dwarf galaxies and tidal dwarf galaxies. Because of the different formation scenarios, we expect we have primordial dwarf galaxies which are dark matter dominated, and tidal dwarf galaxies are lacking dark matter. And because of the different amount of dark matter, these galaxies have different radii, because tidal dwarf galaxies have to be much more compact, because they do not have dark matter particles as a kit to be gravitationally bound. So Grouper 2012 and 2015 said the Lambda CDM predicts the existing of dark matter containing dwarf galaxies and tidal dwarf galaxies. Checking this now in the Elastra simulation, we get the following results. Here we have the stellar mass, and here we have die Stellar Half-Life Radii. Green are simulated tidal dwarf galaxies. Green are simulated dark matter containing dwarf galaxies, and red one are tidal dwarf galaxies. And in between, in magenta, we have dark matter poor dwarf galaxies. So we can see here in this plot, we can distinguish these two different dwarf galaxies. We have two different branches here. And furthermore, these radii of tidal dwarf galaxies are consistent with high resolution runs by Fouquet, and also this radii seems to be at least similar to simulated tidal dwarf galaxies found in the Eagle simulation by Blöckinger et al. Maybe I have to say here that these are less massive in the stellar mass because they apply different selection criteria. And furthermore, I have highlighted here the NGC 1052 DF2 galaxies found by Van Dokkum et al. In 2018. And now there's a huge debate if this galaxy is indeed free of dark matter. Recently, there was a paper by Trujillo which claims that this galaxy is a 13 megaparsec and not a 20 megaparsec, as Van Dokkum claimed. And if this galaxy is a 13 megaparsec, then it's like an ordinary dwarf galaxy which contains dark matter. But if it's really a 20 megaparsec, then this is free of dark matter. And when we compare this galaxy then with simulated tidal dwarf galaxies free of dark matter, then it's very surprisingly how large the effective radii or radius of this object is. So there's no single dark matter free galaxy in the Elastra simulation which has a larger radii than the found DF2 galaxy. But when we look at the plus minus 20% range for the stellar mass and the effective radii, we found just one galaxy, which is like that we found just 1% of all tidal dwarf galaxies are free of, comparable with this Van Dokkum. So this galaxy is rare, but it is in principle consistent with Lambda CDM. So now here we have done a KS test in order to statistically underline that tidal dwarf galaxies and dark matter containing dwarf galaxies follow different distributions. Here we have the stellar radii and here the stellar mass. And what's important here is that the probability that the radius, that the stellar half-life radius follow the same distribution for tidal dwarf galaxies and dark matter containing dwarf galaxies is almost zero. So we have shown for the first time that the dual dwarf theorem is valid in a self-consistent Lambda CDM simulation. But what do we observe in the real universe? And here I will include now in the plot late types from the catalog Dabringhausen and Fellhau in 2018 from the Fornax, Hydra and Centaurus cluster catalog. And then we will get these results. In gray, these are now the observations. The other colors are the same as before. And orange, we see ultra-compact dwarf galaxies and globular clusters. And first of all, we can see again that this DF2 galaxy has also, in comparison to observations, a very high stellar half-life radius. And furthermore, these observations in this mass regime here, which are highlighted with the solid lines, the radii resemble more dark matter-free galaxies than dark matter-containing galaxies. It is not, we cannot really see a splitting in the stellar half-life radius mass. So, yeah. So this is again the KS test. Here the radii and here the stellar mass. The red lines are the tidal dwarf galaxies and gray are observed galaxies. And the probability that these observed ones and the tidal dwarf galaxies with the thick solid lines, the probability for this is 0.29, but comparing this with dark observations with dark matter containing dwarf galaxies, the probability for this is almost zero. When we go back, we can see this makes sense because they are almost going through this data. But there is also now a new Elastra simulation. It's called the Next Generation. And in the first paper they published, I have seen that the radii there are around a factor 2 times smaller than in the Elastra simulation I used here. Unfortunately, the data are not publicly available yet, but I assume just that all radii are by a factor of 2 smaller, so I just divided all the Elastra simulations data by 2, and then I will get this thin lines here are labeled with B. And what is interesting here, that in this case these objects become even more compact, but then the probability is zero and here is no improvement. Yes, but still it is not clear if this factor 2 can be applied for all galaxies. Okay, so the dual dwarf theorem is valid in the Lambda CDM Elastra simulations, but in the observations, there is no evidence for 2 types of dwarf galaxies. We cannot see the splitting accordingly in the radius mass plot for observed late type galaxies. And this was already shown in much more detail by Gruber in 2012 and Darbinghausen and Gruber in 2013. So there's in the observation is no evidence for 2 types of dwarf galaxies, but in the Lambda CDM Elastra simulation we can see different dwarf galaxies populate different regions in the radius mass plot. So I will come to my summary and conclusion. So the most massive tidal dwarf galaxies has a mass similar to the to the Large Magellanic Cloud, which could be a tidal dwarf galaxy. So the found mass spectrum is similar with high resolution simulations. So because of time issues, I haven't shown these plots, but simulated tidal dwarf galaxies are more metal rich than dark matter containing dwarf galaxies. This is again consistent with the formation scenario of tidal dwarf galaxies because they formed out of the gaseous disk of a pre-enriched galaxy. We found a small number of dark matter containing dwarf galaxies. And again, also these galaxies are more metal rich than dark matter rich dwarf galaxies. So this is a first hint that tidal dwarf galaxies can capture a small amount of dark matter. But in order to verify this theory, it is important or one has to really trace the particles through the whole Elastra simulation. This will be then the next step. And tidal dwarf galaxy candidates here are dispersion dominated, so 90% of the tidal dwarf galaxies are dispersion dominated. So is this in contradiction with observation? I put here a question mark because simulations have shown that very young tidal dwarf galaxies should be rotation dominated, but feedback processes can create a lot of supernova explosions, so they lose gas and also a loss of angular momentum. So this could be an issue of feedback processes. And furthermore, in cosmological simulations, more than 50% of all galaxies are dispersion dominated, which is in contradiction, as Pavel mentioned already in his first talk today, that most of the galaxies at redshift zero are disk galaxies. So we have shown for the first time the dual dwarf theorem in a self-consistent Lambda CDM simulation. So, which means that simulated tidal dwarf galaxies are more compact than dark matter containing dwarf galaxies. The radii of the simulated tidal dwarf galaxies are more similar to the observed ones. And my first result about phase-based correlation shows that these tidal dwarf galaxies are indeed phase-based correlated, which we also observe in the universe. especially for Milky Way, Andromeda, and Centaurus A, where we have the best data. But the dual dwarf theorem is falsified by observations. This was shown in detail by Dubringhausen and Grupa, and you also have seen it in the radius mass plot. And therefore, this is a major problem for the Lambda CDM cosmology. And therewith, thank you very much.
We are a bit short in time, but we can take maybe two short questions.
Based on the cosmological simulation, can you tell how long does it take for a tidal dwarf to reach dynamical equilibrium after it's formed? Like, you know, for example, you know the total dynamical mass just by counting particles, and then you can measure the same by looking at the rotational speed or pressure support. Mm-hmm. When, after how long does these two agree indicating an equilibrium configuration?
Yeah, I have to calculate.
It would be very important.
But yeah, this is important that they are in equilibrium. Yeah. Thanks.
On the last point, you show that you have two populations, but one of them you find 100, on the other one you find 60,000. How many do we have to actually observe to be sure that there are no two populations?
Yeah, this is so. We are now at the stage for this hydrodynamic cosmological simulation where we can resolve these tidal dwarf galaxies, but the number of them really depends on the resolution of these galaxies. So I cannot say anything about the number density we should observe here because this strongly depends on the resolutions. Yeah. Sorry.
Okay, let us thank the speaker again.